Thank you, Professor Jean-Paul. My pleasure to talk about beam-steered optical wireless communication. In the previous two presentations, I was not able to attend the first ones, but in the last two ones, I noticed that this was really about widespread optical communication with the risk that you have overlapping cells and thus need to take care of medium access control. By using narrow beams, we envisage to largely eliminate overlaps so that actually every user gets its own beam, which means that medium access control is not a big headache anymore. Based on that, high-speed optical wireless communication is possible, and how we envisage to realize that is the topic of my talk. I also acknowledge my co-authors here, Kitma McConnon, Zizeng Zhao, Frans Huiskens, Nongquan Fong, and Eduard Tangyonga. All of us are at Eindhoven University in the Institute of Photonic Integration and the ECO group. So let me first outline what I would like to tell you. First, why picocells are important for indoor wireless networks in order to increase capacity of such networks. And then in detail, go on the Browse system concept, which is a concept for beam-steered high-speed optical wireless communication. Explain that kind of concept, so that will address how we envisage to have such narrow infrared beams being steered towards the user by just wavelength controlling the optical beam and using diffractive optical elements to steer the beam in two dimensions. Well, steering the beam also means you need to know where the user is. So user localization using passive retroreflection is a technique by which we can achieve that. Then spend some words to the demonstrator we built, showing in our labs that we can indeed realize very high speed communication to nearby users, and then round off with some concluding remarks. So first of all, wireless broadband services indoor by means of steerable beams. Well, as Cooper's law is already telling us, the only way and actually the most powerful way to really increase capacity in wireless networks is to create ever smaller cells. Making ever smaller cells means you can multiply the capacity of the network just by increasing the number of cells, and when you make them small, you can increase that to great height, right? So we can do so with radio waves. As you can see in the upper part of this slide, you see radio waves, millimeter waves being emitted towards devices inside the room. But in this talk, I will mainly focus on light beams, narrow optical beams addressing individual devices. So such narrow beams will allow very high user density, because the energy is focused on a user only. You will get quite a high link budget, and a high link budget allows you to bring high data rates. You get by that also high power efficiency, aiming the beams only there where they need to be. And moreover, the privacy is also much better, because of course users who don't get your beam can also not listen into your traffic, right? So millimeter wave beams is one option, but the most narrow beams you can make with optical techniques. So using lens collimators to make narrow optical beams. And obviously you need to steer those beams to where the user is. So we do so by optically control them and by wavelength tuning. So in the concept you see over here, in the central side at the entrance of the building, there's the residential gateway, which provides access from the public network into the home and vice versa. And inside the home, there is foreseen that there's a fiber network feeding each individual room, and at the ceiling, if you like, of every room is the beam steerer, which can be either for a millimeter wave, but in our particular case, we look for beam steering of infrared beams. So optical beams as such, you need to be careful, of course. You recognize the human eye over here, human eye where the light enters to the cornea first, then it goes to the pupil, it goes to the lens, it goes to the vitreous body, and then it reaches the retina. The retina actually is the part of the eye, as you know, where the light is converted into electrical signals and then goes via the nerves to the brain, where you can see things. So the retina is essential in the whole process, and the retina at the same time is also very vulnerable. Any light which gets onto the retina and is too strong may cause permanent damage there. So therefore, there are eye safety rules which you carefully have to respect. And the nice thing of infrared is that we choose wavelengths which are beyond the visible light, So that means that the light in the visible case obviously would reach the retina, but infrared light is stopped much earlier. It's already stopped at the lens. And if anything is still remaining, it is extinguished in the vitreous body. So almost nothing of the infrared light is reaching the retina. That means that the power limits which are allowed for eye safety rules are much higher for infrared light than for visible light. Infrared light beyond 1400 nanometers is so-called eye safe, and you may go up to 10 milliwatts. Up to 10 milliwatts, which is significantly more than visible and near infrared light. Right? So that means we can allow much higher optical transmit power per beam. As a bonus, also photodiodes responsivity is proportional to wavelength, so a longer wavelength also gives you a higher photodiode responsivity, which means a higher sensitive receiver, and you can shield visible light by just applying infrared transparent filters which block visible light, so that also allows you to eliminate background light to a large extent. So, based on that principle, we proposed a project which was granted by the European Research Council 2012 already. And with that, we built a setup according to the BROWSE's system concept. BROWSE stands for Broadband Reconfigurable Optical Wireless System for Energy Efficient Communication. So pencil beams, as I explained before, pencil beams means you don't need to share capacity with other ones. You have capacity fully for yourself. You may say a pencil beam is like an optical fiber, but then without the fiber. Using infrared, as I mentioned, allows you to go up to pretty high powers. We use beam steerers, which you can see in this picture, mounted to the ceiling. Each PRA is a pencil radiating antenna emitting beams, and the optical beams are steered in the direction determined by the wavelength of the light. So basically, we have tunable lasers in this residential gateway point, and this tunable light is going via fiber to the beam steerer, and from that point onwards, it goes in free space and takes a direction as determined by the wavelength. Well, as you'll see in the future slide, this is a fully passive thing, so we don't need local powering there and can easily scale it to many more beams by just feeding many more wavelengths to the same fiber. And a fiber can transport hundreds of wavelengths, as you probably know. Well, the fact that we use the wavelength for steering the beam means that the wavelength also acts as a control channel. So the wavelength is acting both for control as well as carrying the data. That means that it is an embedded control channel, embedded in the data stream. So as such, you don't need difficult bookkeeping to keep a control signal next to your data signal. That eases network management and control. Well, you can scale it to many beams, just add wavelengths, as already mentioned. And the target we have in this system is to have at least 10 gigabit per second per beam. So we really go for the high end and high capacity communication, wireless communication. Well, this is an example of one way to implement such a beam steerer. You see to the left, the fiber coming in, transporting many wavelengths. Then this, an AWGR, is an arrayed waveguide grating router. That's an optical device which is able to separate those individual wavelengths into many parallel output ports, individual fibers, each transporting one of these wavelengths. We may now just simply rearrange those fibers into a two-dimensional structure, so the matrix over here. If you position this matrix in front of an optical lens, then from your secondary school physics, you know that the position of a fiber with respect to the axis of the lens determines in which direction the beam goes. So that means choosing a wavelength means choosing a fiber over here, and that means choosing a beam direction. And you can have multiple wavelengths, each determining a particular beam direction. So you can generate as many beams as you feed wavelengths into the system and the number of ports you have in your AWGR. So you can design the system such that the lens system, together with the position of the fibers, gives you a full area coverage at the user site. So that's a matter of dimensioning the whole thing. And you will find that it is advantageous to put the fiber array not in the focus of the lens, but a little bit closer, which means the beams will slightly diverge. And if you make a close analysis, you will see that this gives you a better coverage and makes you less dependent on the exact position of the image plane. Moreover, the analysis shows you also that the beam steerer itself requires a much shorter focal length by doing it like this, and that's the way you can reduce the beam steerer size. Well, that's the beam steering part. As I mentioned in the beginning, you also need localization of where the user is in order to steer the beam to the right position. So for that, we are considering an optical element, which you already know from literature probably, that's the corner cube. The corner cube is a nice optical element, which has the nice property that it reflects a beam into exactly back into exactly the same direction as it came in, right? So opposite to a normal mirror, it reflects it exactly in the same direction as it came, only with a small offset. So such corner cube is very interesting to mount nicely close to the photodiode at the receiver side of the user device, right? So that means that the beam hitting the user device will be reflected by this retroreflector, by the corner cube, travels back, and ideally goes into the same fiber as it came from, and then via the optical part upstream, via an optical optical circulator, goes to the location detector, which can then discover that in this particular beam direction, indeed, there's a reflection. So that means there's a user over there. So in this way, we have fully passive localization of the user. Note that this retroreflector is a fully passive device. We don't need any power drain at the user battery for doing this, right? Fully passive. And we find the user by tuning the beam. And tuning the beam actually, as I showed you before, means tuning the laser wavelength. So tuning the wavelength of the signal going into the beam steerer. And wavelength tuning of a laser can really be done very fast. Those devices can tune wavelengths within nanoseconds, right? So in that way, possibly you can scan your area fast and find your user fast. And as soon as you hit the user, then the system knows, hey, that's the position we need to address the user with. So that particular wavelength actually is connected directly to the position. So you don't need a special table connecting wavelength to position. It's already automatically detected by the system. It gives you an auto calibration, so to say. So doing that, if you go into detail again, you will analyze that this corner cube structure needs to be in miniaturized, and that you need an array of them, because that will minimize the offset by which the light is reflected back, which brings you into nice performance of the total system. So what we applied here is a retroreflecting foil. The company Aurafoil makes those things in masses. And these things you may also recognize just from the roadside. If you drive a car, for instance, it will be noticed that every road sign appears pretty bright, although it's just at the side of the road. So apparently the light is coming back to you instead of bouncing further away from you, right? So that's because there are retroreflectors in there. And on the back of your bicycle, you also have retroreflectors that cars can see you, right? So these miniature things are pretty well established. They are cheap, they are robust, widely commercially used and available at very low price. So that's an interesting medium to be deployed for this purpose. So based on that, we built a laboratory system demonstrator having all these features. This is the setup itself in schematic form. You recognize to the right, you recognize two PRAs, which are the beam steerers. The beam steerers, as I mentioned, are equipped with the wavelength selector, meaning that every wavelength goes its own way. We have two PRAs. That means if one device is to be reached and cannot be reached out of the first one because there's a line of sight blocking there, then the other PRA would be able to reach that user still, right? So you have redundancy in the PRA structure to avoid line of sight blocking. At the user side, there is in this case, we use video streaming. So we have an optical receiver over there, which is able to handle up to 10 gigabit Ethernet speed. The beams themselves, they are fed, the beam steerers are fed from fiber. And you see at the head end side, the CCC, the communication controller here, the central communication controller, that's where the video services are injected. We have two times a 10 gigabit Ethernet based video stream, which gives you really high definition video. And then we go via wavelength converter to go to the right wavelength for the tuning. We go into a matrix switch, 2x2 switch, allowing you to switch between the two PRAs. And the return side, there's the return side here in the circumference of your optical aperture. There is the corner cube reflective sheet mounted, so that reflects back light. And then this light will be detected by a power meter over here. which gives the power signal, the amount of power reflected, back to your beam steering control unit, the laptop over here, which commands the wavelength conversion at this point, and so to tune the beam. So with this setup, we showed real-time transmission, 2x high-definition video, each of them embedded in a 10 gigabit Ethernet stream. The beam size is roughly 10 centimeter in diameter, which is a compromise between resolution at one end and the other end. You still need to have enough power inside the optical receiver to have enough power budget. So a beam power launched about 6 dBm, 2.5 meter reach, and we cover in total now around 1.3 meters. So you need several of those to cover a larger area. Well, and this is how it looks like in the lab. So you recognize individual parts. This is our laboratory in the Flux building in TU Eindhoven. In the ceiling, you see 2 PRAs mounted, each of them being fed by this very tiny yellow fiber going up. And the PRA themselves launch the beams towards the user sites, the user plane, which is over here. You see here, very close to each other, 2 optical receivers. Close in the order of some 15 centimeters, 10 to 15 centimeters, each of them able to get an own beam, and then these are fed to the video receivers over there, in which you recognize that the video being sent is there reproduced, right? The video being sent is the one which is sent out of the central unit, which is located over here. You recognize the control laptop over here. Here is the MEMS switch, the 2x2 switch, which allows you to give the redundant switching. And over here you have 2 tunable transmitters, each of them sending this 10 gigabit Ethernet stream, wavelength tunable. Right? Well, this is how the localization effort works. I should have shown it in the previous slide. Also here at the site is the localization power detector, which detects any power being reflected by the reflective foil, the corner cube foil. So what you see when you scan the wavelength, you see that the noise floor, of course, but as soon as you hit a device and you see the corner cube foils with about 5 to 4 centimeter diameter, you see that indeed these 2 individual users are recognized by this relatively strong reflections, right? So in that way you can connect wavelength directly to the user position. Scan the whole area. Sorry?
About 2 minutes.
Okay, I'm close to the end. Scanning the whole area at the moment tilts takes quite some time, and it's mainly because we use laboratory control software on the laptop, LabView control, which is relatively slow. So we're now implementing faster algorithms to make it faster. Okay, that brings me to my concluding slide. So I hope I have shown to you that with optical technologies you can really achieve picocell wireless networks, which go to very high capacity. Narrow infrared beams are very suited to make these ultra high capacity beams. And by wavelength tuning them, you can address individual users. I did not mention, but in our system, we are able to generate 128 beams individually, 128 beams, each able to carry 10 gigabit Ethernet. So we go to more than a terabit per second wireless capacity in the room. Right? And we have shown the feasibility of all this by video live real-time transmission in 10 gigabit Ethernet streams. Well, and I should also acknowledge the funding we got from the European Commission and the Browse Plus project, as well as the company Orafol for providing us this miniature corner cube foil. And with that, I would like to thank you for the attention.